On the 7th of September 1940, German bombers darkened the skies over London, carrying out a raid of startling ferocity. It was the beginning of an intense bombing campaign that would come to be known as the Blitz. Journalist Ernie Pyle, who would go on to win the Pulitzer Prize for his chronicling of the war, was there to witness this sudden and unprecedented night of destruction. It was a night when London was ringed and stabbed with fire. They came just after dark, and somehow you could sense from the quick, bitter firing of the guns that there was to be no monkey business this night. Shortly after the sirens wailed, you could hear the Germans grinding overhead. In my room, with its black curtains drawn across the windows, you could feel the shake from the guns. You could hear the boom, crump, crump, crump of heavy bombs at their work of tearing buildings apart. They were not too far away. Half an hour after the firing started, I gathered a couple of friends and went to a high, darkened balcony that gave us a view of a third of the entire circle of London. As we stepped out onto the balcony, a vast inner excitement came over all of us. An excitement that had neither fear nor horror in it, because it was too full of awe. You have all seen big fires, but I doubt if you have ever seen the whole horizon of a city lined with great fires. Scores of them, perhaps hundreds. There was something inspiring just in the awful savagery of it. The closest fires were near enough for us to hear the crackling flames and the yells of firemen. Little fires grew into big ones even as we watched. Big ones died down under the firemen's valour, only to break out again later. About every 2 minutes, a new wave of planes would be over. Their motors seemed to grind rather than roar, and to have an angry pulsation like a bee buzzing in a blind fury. The guns did not make a constant overwhelming din as in those terrible days of September. They were intermittent, sometimes a few seconds apart, sometimes a minute or more. Their sound was sharp, nearby, and soft and muffled, far away. They were everywhere over London. Into the dark, shadowed spaces below us, while we watched, whole batches of incendiary bombs fell. We saw 24 go off in 2 seconds. They flashed terrifically, then quickly simmered down to pinpoints of dazzling white, burning ferociously. These white pinpoints would go out one by one as the unseen heroes of the moment smothered them with sand. But also, while we watched, other pinpoints would burn on, and soon a yellow flame would leap up from the white center. They had done their work. Another building was on fire. The greatest of all the fires was directly in front of us. Flames seemed to whip hundreds of feet into the air. Pinkish-white smoke bloomed upward in a great cloud, and out of this cloud there gradually took shape, so faintly at first that we weren't sure we saw it correctly, the gigantic dome of St. Paul's Cathedral. St. Paul's was surrounded by fire, but it came through. It stood there in its enormous proportions, growing slowly clearer and clearer, the way objects take shape at dawn. It was like a picture of some miraculous figure that appears before peace-hungry soldiers on a battlefield. The streets below us were semi-illuminated from the glow. Immediately above the fires, the sky was red and angry, and overhead, making a ceiling in the vast heavens, there was a cloud of smoke all in pink. Up in that pink shrouding, there were tiny, brilliant specks of flashing light, anti-aircraft shells bursting. After the flash, you could hear the sound. Up there too, the barrage balloons were standing out as clearly as if it were daytime, but now they were pink instead of silver. And now and then, through a hole in that pink shroud, there twinkled incongruously a permanent, genuine star. The old-fashioned kind that has always been there. Below us, the Thames grew lighter, and all around below were the shadows, the dark shadows of buildings and bridges that formed the base of this dreadful masterpiece. Later on, I borrowed a tin hat and went out among the fires. That was exciting too, but the thing I shall always remember above all the other things in my life is the monstrous loveliness of that one single view of London on a holiday night. London stabbed with great fires, shaken by explosions, its dark regions along the Thames sparkling with the pinpoints of white-hot bombs, all of it roofed over with a ceiling of pink that held bursting shells, balloons, flares, and the grind of vicious engines. And in yourself, the excitement and anticipation and wonder in your soul that this could be happening at all. These things all went together to make the most hateful, the most beautiful single scene I have ever known. While Ernie Pyle watched the fires, young fireman Frank Hurd was in the midst of them, doing the best he could to keep them under control. He and his crew were fighting fires near Beckton Gasworks in East London. What a sight! About a mile away to our right was the riverfront. The whole horizon on that side was a sheet of flame. The docks were afire. On all other sides it was much the same, fires everywhere. The sky was a vivid orange glow, and all the time the whole area was being mercilessly bombed. The road shuddered with the explosions. Anti-aircraft shells were bursting overhead. A Royal Navy destroyer berthed in one of the docks was firing her anti-aircraft equipment, as were other ships. The shrapnel literally rained down. It was now about midnight, and still this incessant racket kept on. It surprised me how quickly one got used to sensing whether a bomb was coming our way or not. At first, we all lay flat every time we heard anything, but after an hour or so, we only dived for it if one came particularly close. Even so, I had a funny feeling inside each time I heard it coming. It took quite a time to overcome that. It wasn't exactly fear, but I don't know now just what it was. At about 3:30 a.m., a canteen van arrived and served us out tea and sandwiches. It was the first bite any of us had had since midday the day before, 14.5 hours ago. Just then, the bombing became more severe and localized. A brighter glow was in the sky immediately over us. Then we saw the flames. They had started another fire in the gasworks, which by now, after about 6 hours concentrated work by us, had been gotten well under control. Then a huge mushroom of flame shot in the air from the docks, followed by a dull, rolling roar. An oil container had exploded. The whole atmosphere became terrible again with the noise of gunfire. Afterwards, when London established its famous barrage, we got used to it. But on that first night, it was just hell. Then, quite suddenly, it ceased. The silence was almost overpowering for a time. Then, about 5 a.m, the all-clear went. We had been subjected, without any real cover, to 8 hours of bombing. There was a shelter constructed in the railway embankment alongside our pump, but it was impossible to get into it. All we could do was to crouch in the entrance, but that was not much use, and we only did it when things got very hot. Relief crews began to arrive, but for some reason known only to the powers that be, our pump was not allowed to leave. We were made up ready for home by 6 a.m. The fire was by then well under control, and our relief crews were ordered home. They had come from Enfield, but we were still there. We stayed there until 10 a.m. on Sunday morning, when our sub-officer handed over control to another officer. This officer and his 10 pumps, we afterward found out, came from Brighton. Our crew proceeded home at 10 a.m, and what a scene of desolation we passed through. Debris everywhere. Confined to the East End, though. I was too tired to care much what I saw then. We had been on our feet since 6:15 p.m. on Saturday until 10 a.m. on Sunday, with only one snack in 21 hours. Luckily, I was on leave on Sunday. Even there, we had to endure another knock. Instead of the usual 24 hours leave from 11 a.m. to 11 p.m, we had to return to duty at 9 p.m. on Sunday night. We were all out again then, at fires. I hate to think of what would have happened had serious fires occurred in other London areas on Saturday night. Since that time, London has been subjected to raids almost every night till now, early December 1940. and in that time I have seen a variety of sights. But it will be a long time before the memory of that first night raid is forgotten. Some of the large dock fires started then burned for upwards of a fortnight, being repeatedly attacked as they were got under control. Shortly after writing this account, in the final days of December 1940, Frank Hurd would be killed by a German bomb. Hundreds of his colleagues fought on, night after night, battling fires that would claim thousands of lives and destroy countless homes, businesses, and other buildings across London. Meanwhile, even young children were coming to terms with the new reality of life under Blitz conditions. Eric Green, a child at the time, later described the terror of fleeing to an Anderson shelter, and the surreal experience of emerging from it when the bombing died down. When we heard the big 4.5 guns on Wanstead Flats open up, we knew something different was up. Then we saw the big formations of German bombers coming over. We were in our Anderson shelters. We had two facing each other, with a sandbagged dugout entrance between them. The bombs began to whistle down, some with a dreadful screaming sound. There was a bang at the entrance. We thought a bomb or something had fallen in the entrance, but to our relief it was Rover, our scruffy sheepdog, crashing in at full speed. Poor thing. He was terrified. We crouched in our shelters, pretty frightened, I can tell you, with our first experience of the terrors of war at first hand. This went on for about 3 hours, the whistling of bombs falling and the ground shaking from the explosions. We all thought it was our lot. We thought nobody could survive this. Then, as things began to quieten down, my father and I climbed out of the shelters and, to our relief, we saw our house was still standing. But when we looked to the end of our row of houses, the last couple were not there. They had been blown up. Then, on our right, where there were blocks of flats 4 stories high, sticking out of the roofs were big pieces of metal, about 20 feet long. My father said that they were pieces of railway line. The front and back door had been blown off, and a lot of glass from the windows was strewn everywhere. My father said, "I'll check upstairs." I went out of the front door, or at least where the front door should have been. The first thing I noticed was that the signal box opposite our house was tilted at an angle of 45 degrees, and debris was everywhere. Between our front door and the house next door, I saw this big hole about 5 feet across and about 4 feet deep. Jumping down into it, I could see some metal sticking up. Then my father came out of the house and, seeing me down the hole all excited, took one look and grabbed me by the collar and hauled me out. "Quick," he shouted. "Get everyone back into the shelters. It's an unexploded bomb." The metal I could see in the hole must have been the top of the tail fins of the bomb, and I had jumped down on top of it. My mother was in a terrible state, what with the bombs and being told that our neighbours, a few doors away, had received a direct hit on their shelter, and that their bodies were found on the railway line opposite.
I got nightmares in my head, I fear that the thoughts build up until I can't hear, that my mind fills up.